Good morning. It's good to be together this morning as we come to worship the Lord and as we come to share in His supper together as the family of God in this place. Let me just share a couple of announcements before we do begin our time of worship together. First one is to say that hopefully where you're sitting on the pews, there will be some of the individual elements that we've been using now for the last year or so. If you don't have those and you need one, then just take a look around you. I think there are some spare at the doors as well, so feel free to get up during a hymn or whenever you need to, just to take one of those. But please don't be without if you want to be able to share in the Lord's Supper together. Connect groups return this week, so they'll be meeting on Tuesday, Wednesday and Friday evenings, and as we said before, that will continue online until Christmas, and then we'll look at things again then. There is this handout at the back. It's an updated one for this week, so for the second I Am, we're going to take a bit of time to look in more detail about what it means for Jesus to be the light of the world. So please do take one of those handouts with you today if you're part of one of those groups, or even if you maybe struggle to get online and you want to take a look at it and you want to be part of it in that way, please do feel free to take one on your way home today. And it's still up to you to be able to join in with those groups. As I say, they meet on Tuesday, Wednesday, and there's a smaller group in particular on Friday. So if you want to maybe join in with any of those, please let me know. And Buggy Buddies is going to restart this Friday in the McCloy Hall, and that's a group for all pre-nursery children and their parents or carers or grandparents, and that runs from 10 until half 11 each Friday, and there'll be the likes of hand sanitizer and social distancing and all toys that are thoroughly clean. So please pass that on to anyone who you think could really benefit from that. Restart this Friday at 10 o'clock in the hall. Just come in via Castleton Avenue. Next Sunday, the 3rd of October, it's worth just bearing in mind that it's the Belfast City Marathon that has moved to a Sunday, probably as we all know, so if anybody needs to leave a bit of extra time for their journey, it's worth bearing that in mind. I think the nearest that comes to us is Dunkery Street in one direction and the Andrum Road in another, but just in case maybe anybody comes from a little bit further out, it's just worth bearing that in mind. And then in two Sundays time, Sunday the 10th of October, it's going to be our annual Harvest Thanksgiving, and I'm going to do a pulpit swap that Sunday with the minister in Rathcoole, Craig Lynn, so he will be here in 2 weeks time, and I will be in Rathcoole sharing with them in their harvest. That's the 10th of October. And then finally also on the 10th of October in the evening time, a little bit later in the day, we're going to start our new way of meeting on Sunday nights, Alexandra PM. It's going to begin on Sunday the 10th at 6:30, and we'll have some more detailed information about that next week in written form, as well as hearing a bit more about what it involves. We're going to kick off with a 5-week series on stories of everyday missions. We're going to hear from a different person or people each week, people who are deliberately living out their faith in various different ways and contexts, and maybe some encouragements and some information for us, maybe in how we can do that and how we can think a little bit more about that in whatever context we're in, wherever God has placed us. So we're going to do that in different sort of ways, and that's going to begin on Sunday the 10th of October at 6:30. Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 130. Let me read from verses 3 to 7. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits for him. And in his word, I put my hope. I wait for the Lord. More than the watchmen wait for the morning, more than the watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, God's people, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. We are glad of that, aren't we, as we meet together this morning. We praise and we worship God because of that, because with him, in his unfailing love and grace, there is full redemption for all who turn to him. Let's praise God as we sing the words of our opening hymn. We're going to stand together and the words will be on the screen. How can I be free? Let's praise God.
Thank you.
Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful today that we are able to meet before and praise the one who is the very Lord Almighty, the one who was forever, the one who is, and the one who will forever be. Father, we come before the one who has no beginning or end, the one who is everlasting, the one who has made everything in this world, the one who has created every living thing. Lord, you're the one who sustains everything that you've made day by day by day. Lord, we come before you and we realize your might and your power. Lord, we realize your majesty. We realize that you are the one that we are right to bow before, to glorify, to magnify, to praise for the gift of life itself. And Lord, you are also the one who is powerful and righteous and holy. Lord, as the psalmist says, if the one who is perfect and holy and righteous and almighty, Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, which one of us could stand? Lord, which one of us would come through those doors? And we know the answer to that rhetorical question is not one of us. Lord, not one of us would dare to stand in your presence. Not one of us would dare to come through the door and dare to worship you this morning. Yet, Father, we are thankful today. Thankful that with you there is forgiveness, as the psalmist reminds us of. Lord, thankful that in our sinful state that you have reached down and that you've saved us, you have rescued us. Lord, we are thankful that while we were still sinners, you sent your Son. You sent our Redeemer. Lord, you sent him to rescue us from the pattern and from the pain and from the shame of this world. And Lord, we thank you that you have done that because of your steadfast, loyal love. You've done that because you're full of grace. Lord, you've done that through the riches of your grace, as your word tells us. And so, Father, as we come to worship this morning and as we come to share in this supper that you've given us and you've left behind for us, Lord, we realize that we really do need to be led to the cross of Jesus. Lord, we realize that to be free from guilt and the power and the pain and the shame of sin, Lord, we can make no other plea than coming to the cross of Jesus. Lord, help us to know that this is all that we need. Help us to know that this is all that we can plead when that day comes, and help us to trust in Jesus and his blood that was shed for us. Lord, help us to gather around the table this morning and to know this, Lord, to know this more powerfully, to know more of the reality of this, Lord, that we don't need other things, that, Lord, we cannot plead in anything else, whether it be ourselves or something else, and, Lord, we can't look for anything other than Jesus and his blood that was shed for us. Father, help us to know that we can put our hope in the Lord. For in you there is unfailing love, and with you there is full redemption. Father, as we gather around the table this morning especially, may we know these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to turn and read from God's word as we turn to the book of Ephesians, chapter 1. I'm going to read the opening 10 verses of the book. If you have your Bible with you, then please do turn to that, or the words, as always, will be on the screen. So Ephesians chapter 1, and I'll begin to read verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to God's holy people in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise for spiritual blessings in Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have the redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished upon us with all wisdom and understanding. He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reached the fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. Amen. We thank God for his word to us. Well, those who are heading out to creche and KFC, you're able to make your way out there. We want to join together in prayer with our prayer intercession, our prayers, Father. So let's do that now as we join our hearts in prayer. Father God, as we come to share in this supper this morning, we remember the first time that this was given to us by Jesus. Lord, we remember that occasion, that evening, Lord, where the disciples and where Jesus gathered together. Lord, we remember the impending betrayal that Jesus would face. We remember the news that he broke to his disciples. And we remember the agony and the pain and the shame which were all just hours away for Jesus. Father, with that in mind, we come with our prayers, we come with our intercessions to the one who, Lord, who not only knows our struggles and our pains, but the one who has bore these things on himself, the one who has bore our struggles, pain, and shame. We come to the one in prayer who needs no introduction to the pain that this world brings on a daily basis for most of us. And Father, as we come, we also remember, Father, the fact that Jesus has died that we might know freedom from our sin, we might know a freedom, Lord, from the effects and from the cause of sin in this world. And so, Father, we pray that you'd help us to lean into the one who not only has borne our pain and our shame, but the one who has died to set us free from the things that come through this world. Father, this morning we also want to pray for the weary, Lord, for those who continue on day by day, weary with many things. Lord, weary because of the way the world is at this moment in time. Weary with worry, with stress, maybe even just with the routines of life or the change that the last couple of years has brought about. Lord, we pray for those who are weary with what seemed like ordinary everyday things turning into maybe uphill tasks. Those who are weary of wondering what the next few weeks or months will bring. Father, we pray for people who may be like that, who may be in that situation here among our number today. And we also remember those who aren't, those that we know, those that will listen to these words or watch this service a little bit later on. Father, we pray that you'd help us to remember and to hold on to those words of Jesus, that we can come to him. All of us who are weary and burdened can come to Jesus, and we can know his promise of rest. So, Lord, those who are able to gather around the table today, help us to remember that we are able to encounter our Saviour because he is risen and he has conquered the grave. And help us to know that those words, that promise, that offer continues to be before us. Lord, feed us and nourish us, we pray, as we share together in this supper. And Lord, most of all, help us to look to Jesus. Help us to know that he is with us each step of the way. And all those who are weary and burdened can know an offer of rest. Lord, strengthen us, we pray, in a way that we know we cannot find anywhere else in this world. Help us to know that as we worship you, as we meet together, we are together in your presence. And help us to know a strength that comes through that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I wonder if you've ever accidentally overheard someone talking about you, not in a bad way, but maybe in a good way, maybe in a way that actually you were quite glad to have been able to hear. Admittedly, that hasn't happened to me all that often. Maybe occasionally, maybe you're walking away from people who, maybe whispering isn't their strongest point. Maybe they're not all that good at speaking in hushed tones, and maybe you've heard them say something good or nice or complimentary or whatever it may be. Something that really gives you confidence. Something that actually you've been quite glad that you heard. You've been quite glad that you heard them say. You know, the start of the book of Ephesians, as Paul writes it, comes with lots of rich language, comes at times with what seems like very heavy and dense theological words which maybe we have to read again and again to get a real grasp of. But the start of Ephesians is exactly like that for believers. It's exactly like that as Paul writes to the church in Ephesus. As he writes to these believers, to these Ephesians, to these people who are young in their faith, he writes to them and he wants to remind them of what is theirs. He wants to write to them and he wants to remind them of what can be said about them because of their faith in Jesus. As we come, as we read these words together, as we hear these words today, it's just like Paul is talking about us. It's just like Paul is talking about believers like us who gather today. Those who have a faith in Jesus. Those who have a confidence that their sin, they're rescued from their sin rather because of their faith in him. And it's just like he's writing for us to be able to overhear, coming along as we are, picking these words up 2,000 years later. He's writing about people like you, and he's writing about people like me. And you know, as we gather here today, that's important for us to remember. It's important for us to know who we are. It's important for us to know what can be said about us as believers. And you know, what Paul wrote to these Ephesians, what he wrote to this church in this particular place, is exactly what he could write about us if he sent this letter here, if he sent this letter for me or someone else to read out. Look again and listen again at how he begins it. Listen again at who he writes this letter to. He reminds us that we are God's holy people. We are God's holy people, not in Ephesus, but in Belfast. We are the faithful in Christ Jesus. We too are people who know that they are on the receiving end of grace and peace, as he says in verse 2. The opening of this letter has been described as a doxology. It's like a poem of praise to God, a poem that goes on and on for quite a long time, and it went on even after we left our reading in verse 10. And this poem of praise to God helps us to see who we are, helps us to see what he has done for us, and helps us to see, pardon me, what is on
us? What can be said about us? And so if you gather here this morning, if you come here any Sunday and you're trusting in nothing and no one other than Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, then this is what can be said about you. If you're eating this bread and drinking from this little cup this morning and you're trusting in Jesus and Jesus alone, then God wants to remind you of what you can be sure about this morning. You know, this little part of the word, it can be difficult for us, can't it, to hear things like that. It can be difficult for us maybe to accept these things. Sometimes our insistence on being humble or insistence on humility can sometimes make us pull the shutters down very quickly, can't it? Or sometimes it can make us come up with reasons very quickly why these things shouldn't be said about us. Oh, no, we don't really want to hear those sort of things. But these things that Paul writes here at the beginning of Ephesians, they're undisputably and they're undeniably and they are eternally ours as we trust in Jesus, and we need to be reminded of them. And the church in Ephesus, well, they needed to be reminded of them too, and that's why Paul doesn't leave this doxology, that's why this beginning to the letter doesn't end just after these opening couple of verses. But he goes on to emphasize why these things are true. He goes on to explain more and more about what truth there is in these things for all believers, for people like us. As we approach the table this morning, we should be reminded about these things that Paul goes on to say. He says that in Jesus we are blessed, in Jesus we are redeemed, and in Jesus we are forgiven. He says that we are blessed. That's the first thing that Paul brings out of these first few verses in Ephesians. I wonder what your mind tends to turn to whenever you think or whenever you hear of someone being blessed. Maybe quite often it's the answers to our prayers, isn't it? Or maybe more specifically it's the Lord answering our prayers in the way that we feel they should be answered, in the way that we feel is right for God to answer our prayers. Maybe you look at someone who has a nice home to live in, or you look at someone whose health is strong even in older age, or you look at someone whose children are doing them proud and not causing them problems. Maybe we look at people like that and we think, ah, they're blessed. Even as believers, we look at people like that and we think, that's what it means to be blessed. That's what it looks like to be blessed. But that's not really what Paul talks about here, is it? He doesn't mention any of those things or things like that. He points to blessings which are found in Jesus. In fact, he talks about every spiritual blessing in Christ. And what he goes on to talk about, what Paul goes on to describe, well, they can't be found anywhere other than him, can they? They're for those who know him. They're for those whose life is spent in him, for those who have repented and trusted in him, and for those who know Jesus, for those who know him as their Lord. Every spiritual blessing in Christ is what Paul says. And these blessings, well, they don't always automatically tie up with what we might think about or what we might think it is to be blessed. They don't always include the sort of things that might be top of our prayers, either for ourselves or for someone else. And that's because Paul is helping us to see that God's blessing, that to be blessed in Jesus, to be blessed in Christ, it doesn't mean that we are predominantly blessed with material things, with stuff, with things, even good things that we might often pray for. Why is that? Why might that be? Well, maybe it's because for those who are in Christ, Jesus reminded them, he reminded us that that will mean taking up our cross and following him. That's what it looks like to be in Christ often, to take up our cross and to follow him. If you're coming after me, Jesus says, you're going to follow me, then you need to die. To die to your old self. You need to choose my ways over your own. And that reminds us that often discipleship is costly. Often to follow Jesus, often to be in Jesus, that is costly. Sometimes that means not knowing the things that we might pray for the most, not having God answer our prayers in the way that we would want them to be answered the very most. And it means, as Paul himself reminded us in Romans 8, that as we are in Christ, often that means sharing in his sufferings, being like him in that way. And so knowing the blessing of Jesus, it doesn't always, or maybe even all that often, mean that we have our prayers answered in the way that we should, or some of the things that we're praying for at least. But what are these blessings? What blessing does Paul talk about here? Well, the blessing that he talks about here, they are richer than anything that I would say we would dare to pray for, that we would dare to ask God if we didn't read them in his word. They are beyond our wildest imagination. He introduces us to them in verses 4 and 5. This is a sort of blessing that comes from Jesus. To know that he has chosen us in him before the creation of the world, to be known as people who are holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and his will. You know, James is at that age where he struggles to comprehend anything before he was born. Things that happened before 2015, he really struggles to take that in. He looks at the photograph of our wedding and he wonders why he wasn't there. He wonders what is going on. And so trying to figure out at one point that his mum was a little girl, or trying to figure out at one point his dad was a little boy, that's a struggle for him at his age. Trying to take in what happened before he was born is difficult for him to grasp. You know, as we read how we are blessed, maybe these things are difficult for us to grasp. Maybe it's difficult for us to grasp that in God's mercy, in his grace, he has known us, he has chosen us, and he has adopted us, not before we were born, but before the creation of the world. Not before we were born, not before our parents were born, not even just before Paul wrote these words, not even just before Jesus came into our world as a helpless baby, not even just before Adam and Eve ushered sin into the world by taking that fruit from the garden, but before it all. Before all of it, the Lord knew us. Before all of it, he knew your name. Before all of it, he knew all about you. Before all of it, he chose you. He chose to adopt you as his daughter or his son, to bring you into his family. And that happened before the creation of the world. And that is hard to grasp, isn't it? But it's true. And it's true, and it is initiated by God himself, isn't it? Listen to these things that we're told and how we are blessed. For he chose us. For in love he predestined us. And he made known the mystery of his will. All of this is because God has chosen to do it. Why did he do this? Why did he choose us? Simply and purely because of his grace. As Paul will go on to say, the richest of his grace. There's nothing in us to make God love us. There's nothing in us to make God adopt us or to choose us or to bring us into his family. Why did he predestine us? So that his glory might be seen and might be known. Why did he adopt us? So that we might be able to call him our Father. And there is nothing which makes God do these things. They come from his love and they come out of his grace. You know, if you're coming to this table this morning and you are trusting in Jesus, then you are blessed. I am blessed. We are blessed far beyond what we would dare to pray for, and yet what Paul reminds us is true of us. We are blessed beyond how we could ever imagine. But we are also something else. You know, today we're gathered for worship and we're gathered to break bread in the Lord's Supper. But if we were meeting a couple of thousand years ago, this would all look and feel very different, wouldn't it? When the early church met to share the supper and the remembrance of the one who had died for them, well, people on the outside were very suspicious, weren't they? They didn't look maybe with respect or reverence, or however some people might look at the church or might even look at us. They met on Sunday, they met on that first day of the week, because that's when Jesus had been risen. But it was also part of the working week. It was part of the day when people were going about their work and their business. And so when did they meet? They met early in the morning. They met before they had to go and do their day's work or business as well. And as they met to share together in this supper, what were they talking about? They were talking about things like eating the body and drinking the blood. And here are these people meeting early in the morning, meeting away from everyone else, and they're talking about things like this. People were deeply suspicious of these people. Deeply suspicious of this cult or these cannibals who seem to be coming together or talking along these lines. But on they persevered. On they continued to meet together, and on they continued to talk about Christ's body and his blood. Why was that? It was because of another of these words which are true about us. Because of what Paul tells us in verse 7, that we are redeemed. As we meet together today, it's important for us to continue to remember that because of Christ's blood, we are redeemed. In him we have the redemption through his blood, Paul tells us. And that's why it's important for us, isn't it? To break bread together and also to drink from this cup. Because we are redeemed. You know, redemption is one of those terms that we use a lot, isn't it, when we meet together. But it really helps to tie together the big picture of God's work throughout the Bible. We see right throughout Scripture that when something or someone was redeemed, it was bought back at a price. Like a slave maybe who's in that position because of poverty, well, they could be bought out of that. They could be redeemed if someone would come and pay the price that was on their head. And so they would have freedom because someone would come and redeem them out of it. And you know, just before the summer, our Connect groups looked at the book of Ruth, and there is such a clear and helpful theme of redemption and redeeming that runs through that Old Testament book of Ruth. Naomi and Ruth were told at the start were without husbands, and because they were without husbands at the start of the story, they were without an income and a security and maybe even a guarantee of life itself. And then we're told of how it worked in Israel at that time. There was a guardian redeemer who had the chance to be able to redeem Ruth, someone who was within the family but a little bit further out. It fell to them, or the opportunity fell to them, to be their guardian redeemer, to be able to take them under their wing, to be able to help them out, and to be able to pay the price that was needed for women like this. We're not told about his name in Ruth, are we? But we're told that he turned down the opportunity to do that. He didn't take the chance because all the baggage that came with it, because maybe his own estate would be in danger. It was too costly for this person to be the redeemer, the guardian redeemer of Naomi and Ruth. But then we're told about Boaz, aren't we? We're told about Boaz, who had no obligation whatsoever to people like this. No obligation whatsoever to Naomi and to Ruth. And yet he chooses to redeem. He chooses to be their guardian redeemer under the Israelite law. And he paid the price that was needed. And the amazing thing that out of this story, out of this act of redeeming, came our Redeemer. What are we told at the end of the story? Boaz was the father of Obed. And Obed was the father of Jesse. And Jesse was the father of David.
And the gospel writers are at pains to point out that who is Jesus descended from? He is descended from David. And as heroic as Boaz was, as good as his actions were, that he would redeem not only a widow but her poor mother-in-law, what he did, what God did as he stitched the story of his word together, was to provide our Redeemer, was to provide our Redeemer who would come and choose to pay the price. And not only would his estate be at risk, not only would he have to meet the price that was set, but he would shed his own blood to be able to do it. As we meet together this morning, we need to remember that we are redeemed by his blood, as Paul tells us here. Redeemed by the only thing that would meet the cost. You know, the price of sin always demands a payment, doesn't it? And the payment for our sin has been met by the blood of Christ, the one who is perfect and spotless and righteous. We might hope, we might try to be redeemed by other things. We might try to be redeemed by our standing in the community. We might try to be redeemed by making sure we have a clear conscience. We might try to be redeemed by treating other people as we would want to be treated. But we were only redeemed by Christ's blood. And so this morning, as we share together the bread, and in particular as we drink from the wine, we should remember that not only are we blessed, but we are redeemed. And finally, Paul wants us to see one other thing that we can be sure about today. We are forgiven. You know, maybe as we draw around the Lord's table, maybe as we come together to share in the Lord's Supper, maybe you become very aware of your shortcomings. Maybe you become acutely aware of your sin. Maybe as we focus on the one who has redeemed us, maybe as we focus on the one who is sinless and perfect and holy and has died in our place, maybe you can't help but be confronted and reminded of your sins. Maybe those things that we kind of try to put to one side day by day, maybe some of those things we try to push deep down week by week, those things that we know are wrong, those thoughts that we give our time to, those things that we are involved in, or the way that we treat certain people, that we try to forget them for most of the time. But when we come to the table, maybe it's hard. Maybe it's really difficult to forget those things. Maybe you're confronted, maybe I'm confronted by my sin as we gather for the Lord's Supper. But let me tell you, I am glad that I am not only reminded of my sins at this table, but I am glad that I am reminded that I am forgiven because of this table. And that's what Paul wants us to see here. Paul wants us to see and to know that because of Jesus, and because we trust in him and in him alone, our sins are forgiven. They are not only swept under the carpet temporarily. They are not taken from us a little bit, but the stain left, but they are removed from us. They are lifted. You know, for all of the advancement in medical science, we're still reminded, aren't we, that we're waiting for that treatment for the common cold. We're still waiting to be able to be treated fully and properly for things that we will all pick up, for things that will all come our way, things that we will see and experience during the winter time as we move into them. And you know, we can mask their symptoms, can't we? We can take a tablet here, or we can take one of those disgusting hot drinks there, but it doesn't take it away. It just masks what is there. As Paul reminds us of who we are, he says that we are blessed because our sins are not masked, but they are removed. They are lifted from us. As he tells us in verse 7, we have the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace, which he has lavished upon us. You know, Paul uses appropriately grand language here, inundated with grace, as one writer puts it.
a reminder of who God is. He's not the one who is out to get us. He is not the one who delights in punishing us, but he is the one who is actively pursuing us. He is the one who wants us to know the forgiveness of our sins. He's the one who wants us to know that we have been forgiven, that they have been lifted from us because of Jesus, because the price has been paid. And he is the one who lavishes his grace upon us. He doesn't ration us. He inundates us with his grace. And so no matter the sin, no matter how far we feel we have gone, his grace is lavished upon us as we come to him for forgiveness. You know, maybe we read these words, maybe we read this description of who we are, maybe we struggle to take in the magnitude of this. But as we come to the table, especially this morning, we should know that if our faith is in him, then we are blessed. We are blessed beyond our wildest imagination. Blessed as we know that we are chosen, that we are adopted into his family. We are blessed far beyond what we would dare to pray for. And we are people who are redeemed. We are bought back at a great cost. We are bought back at the cost of his blood on the cross. And we are people who are forgiven. Our sins have not been masked. The effects of our sins have not been dulled, but they have been lifted from us because we are forgiven in him. And it comes out of the riches of his grace. Let's pray as we approach the table. Father, we thank you for these grand words of Paul. Lord, help us to read them again and again until we can take them in. Lord, help us to know that as our faith is in Jesus, as our Lord and our Savior, he is talking about people like us. We are blessed, we are redeemed, and we are forgiven. Father, may we know these things as we gather around the table this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We come now to join together for the Lord's Supper. And on Wednesday past, we joined for our pre-communion service, and it was our real pleasure to be able to welcome Sandra Higgins back into full membership here with us in Alexandra. It's been great to have Sandra and Harry with us over the last year or more, and to be able to suppose for many people to reacquaint themselves, and for me to be able to get to know them both. And it's great to have them with us. Well, as we come to the Lord's table, we want to remember again the invitation that is ours to be able to join together. Words that we stop to think about in our pre-communion service. The words of John. He says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And as we come to the table this morning, we want to remember the Lamb of God. We want to remember the one who takes away our sins. We want to remember the one in whom we are blessed. We want to remember the one because of we are forgiven. We want to remember the one who knows that we are redeemed in him. And so we come with that invitation from the Lord himself, those words that we've thought about in our recent series. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." And so, echoing those words of Jesus, I invite you to come to the table now. And we remind ourselves that
the table of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's open to all who are in communion with the church worldwide, all who are part of his church, living, active parts of the church of which Jesus is the head. And so if you're trusting in Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, then you should come and you should join together in this supper this morning. If you're honest with yourself, if that's not where you are yet, if those are still things that you're wrestling with and thinking about, then don't come out of habit. Don't come to try to be more religious. Don't come trying to please God or other people. But if you love Jesus as your Savior, if you're living with him as your Lord, then come and know that he invites you. Let me read the words of 1 Corinthians 11 as Paul tells us about the Lord's Supper is instituted. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Well, if you still need some of the little elements, then please take a look around you in the pews, or feel free to head to the back and make sure you lift one if you are wanting to share in the Lord's Supper together. Just before we do that, we're going to sing from hymn 399, "From Heaven You Came, Helpless Babe." Let's stand as we praise God together.
Thank you.
Let's just pray together as we approach the table. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the one who came not to be served, but to serve. And Lord, the one who came to give himself for us. Lord, the one who set his face towards the cross, and the one who has paid the price so that we might be forgiven and we might know that we have been redeemed. So, Father, we come trusting in him. We come looking to him. And we pray that you would enable us to know him in all of his grace and all of his mercy and the truth of all that he is. Lord, help us to know that by your Spirit you are at work in our hearts as we share together in this supper. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so Jesus was the one who took bread, and on the night he was betrayed, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take and eat together the body of Christ, which is broken for us. And in the same way, when the supper was over, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." And so we take and we drink together and we remember the blood of Christ which has been shed for us. Let's close in prayer. Father, so soon we will move away from this table, or we will scatter and we will go our own way. And Lord, the challenges of life, the routines of life, everything that's asked of us in life will soon come our way. But Father, we pray that you would help us to hold on to the truth of what we've been reminded of. Lord, this truth that we have acted out, that we have lived out in remembrance of Jesus. That we have a Saviour whose body was broken for us. And that we have a Saviour whose blood was shed for us. So that we might live as your sons and your daughters. So that we might know blessing beyond measure as our sins are forgiven. Lord, help us to go from this place knowing that we are people who are blessed and redeemed and forgiven. Lord, may we know that you didn't only gather with us as we come together to be with each other, but help us to know that, Lord, you go with us by your Spirit. Lord, you keep that promise to be with us and to help us and to encourage us, and through your Spirit to be our guide. May we know the reality more and more of this day by day in our lives. And in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. And so as we sing our closing praise, we want to be reminded, we want to know that not only do we have a Saviour who has died for us, but we have a Saviour who has conquered the grave, and a Saviour who is risen. And so we're going to sing hymn 442, Thine Be the Glory. Let's stand together as we pray. Amen.